give my disclaimer now for all you new folks. I've done got a hold of my fingers, don't want to work anymore, so my guitar playing ain't too hot. So, just have to go along with it. Savior that sticks to us like a brother, better than a brother. Number 51 is American Baptist. We are secure in our salvation. If you're saved, ain't nobody take it away from you. It's yours. No matter how they try or how they try to say that you can lose it, you can't, because it's God that holds it, we don't. Number 51. This is another problem too with old age. Your brain doesn't want to work.
Yeah. this evening. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you again tonight. Father, we are thankful that you have allowed us to be able to have this week where we have been able to come together each night to look to your word, to hear your word proclaimed to us. Father, thank you for the messages, for the word that we have heard. Father, thank you for Brother Gary and his willingness to come and present your word to us. Lord, as we go throughout our services tonight, continue to bless him with the ability to recall what he has studied. Help us to continue to have our hearts and our minds open to your word. Lord, you've heard the prayer requests that we made mention of tonight, those unspoken, but that are upon our hearts. We have several that are continuing to fight and battle through different diseases, illnesses. Father, heal them, give them back their strength. For those who are recovering from surgeries, continue to help their bodies to heal and recover, that they might be able to return to your services. Lord, we do ask that you would continue to forget those that are perhaps dealing with the loss of loved ones and comfort them. Lord, we do ask that you continue to bless this church and our ability to be a light and a witness to you here in our community. Help us to be mindful of the things that we need to be doing. Help us to have the grace and strength we need to accomplish them. Lord, do forgive us of our sins and of our shortcomings. For in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Number 153. We don't have to worry about the fear of tomorrow. No, the Lord said, don't worry about tomorrow. Just take care of today. Through those times. He's our hiding place. Number 306.
I have found a hiding place with sword and strength. Jesus rock and rage is strong and true. In a weary land I in his shadow rest. He is my strength in all that I do. Jesus rock of ages, let me hide in thee. Jesus for the chair and sweet the heart to me. Lily of the valley, bright and morning star, fairest help in thousands to my soul. I have found the sweetest flower that ever grew. Jesus from the sharing, fair and pure. Be my joy and comfort, blessed friend, so true. He lives within my heart evermore. Jesus, rock of ages, let me hide in thee. Jesus, rose of sharing, sweet the heart to me. Lily of the valley, bright and morning star, fairest of 10,000 to my soul. I have found the only star that shines on high. Jesus, bright and morning star to be. In the night of sorrow, he is ever nigh. He grabs the darkest shadows away. Jesus, rock of ages, let me hide in thee. Jesus, rose of sharing, sweet the heart to me. Lily of the valley, bright and morning star, fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Praise the Lord, I'll be a winner.
Anybody else? I'll let you use it.
Cover some territory here, okay? But we're not going to do all these verses. We're only going to do a few of them, all right? right? But I want you to understand that Paul was considered a traitor to the Jewish people. They didn't like him. They had ill will towards him. And think about this for just a second about Paul. Paul, in his lifetime, was stoned. He was left for dead. He was threatened. He was let down out of a window to keep from being killed. And God delivered him every time. And it, carrying on with the theme of the week, on Monday night, we looked at having a Joshua heart. On Tuesday night, we looked at having a Nehemiah heart. Wednesday night was a David heart. Last night was a Mary Magdalene heart. Tonight, we're going to look at having a Paul heart. The first thing I want you to look at is verses 1 through 3 of Romans chapter 9. He said, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. The first thing I want you to notice tonight is that as Paul's going through the book of Romans, he is taking a lawyer approach. And as he's going through this, he's doing a question and answer type session. And up to this point, he has told them why the law was fulfilled in Christ and what need they had for Christ. But when it comes to chapters 9, 10, and 11, he breaks from that. Because he wants them to see his heart. He wants them to see why he's doing it. So in this first section tonight, I want you to see Paul had a burdened heart for the people of Israel. He had a burdened heart for those who didn't have Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Paul says in verse 3 that he would even give himself if that meant that his fellow countrymen would accept Christ. He would become a curse just for them. He loved his country. He was a Jew through and through. But he understood that being a Jew was not enough. You see, when Paul looked at Christ, he rejoiced. But when he looked at his countrymen and the people of Israel, he wept. Because he wanted them to know that God was faithful, but they had rejected him. Pay attention. You can look in verse 4. And you can see all the things that God showed Israel. And Paul explained them all, right? He says in verse 4, he said they had adoption. They had glory. They had covenants. They had the law of Moses. They had the service of God. They had the promises of God. And they still rejected every single one of them. What's Paul saying? Paul is saying here that salvation is not found in natural descent. It's not found in human merit. It's only found in the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And a person cannot get to heaven if he doesn't have Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter what country he was born in. It doesn't even matter what tribe he was born in. He can be a Jew of all Jews. He can be the purest Jew there ever was, and you would still burst hell wide open without Jesus Christ. You see, Paul's heart was burdened because people were resting in their heritage and in their merit rather than in the blood of Christ. We can even go back to the days of Jesus Christ. When Jesus was walking on this earth, Jesus met a rich young ruler, and that rich young ruler was a Jew. You say, how do I know he was a Jew? Because he kept the law. If you weren't a Jew, you didn't keep that law. And what happened? That rich young ruler looked at Jesus and he said, I've kept the law from the day of my birth. And what did Jesus ask him? He said, sell all you have and give it to the poor. Come and follow me. And what did it say that rich young ruler did? It said he turned, he wept, and he walked away. Because he was looking for salvation in his merit. He was looking for salvation in what he done to keep the law. I want to be honest with you tonight. It doesn't matter how much of the law you can keep. It doesn't even matter how much of the law you know. If you don't have the blood of Jesus Christ on your heart, you will die and go to hell. I can't sugarcoat it. I can't put it in any other plainer English. Without Jesus Christ, we have no hope. Paul knew this. Because in Paul's earlier days, he was a Jew of all Jews. He even persecuted the church. He went around, and if you read the book of Acts, Paul even admits in the book of Acts to Luke, who wrote the book of Acts for him, that he even murdered Christians. Paul knew what zeal was. Paul knew what the law was. But Paul has also witnessed the saving grace of Jesus Christ. We have a question to ask ourselves here. Does this mean that God's word had failed because Israel failed? The answer is unequivocally no. God is faithful no matter what men do with his word. God's faithful. Paul's heart was burdened because people rejected God. People rejected the sacrifice. People rejected the truth. You see, we still have people in today's time that do the exact same thing. We want to hold on to a little piece of God's word here, and a little piece of God's word there, and a little piece of God's word there. And then we want to sit around and tell everybody, I'm a Christian, but have never given our lives to Jesus Christ. Then we want to turn around and also say we're a Christian, but never have a burden for lost souls. I want to be honest with you tonight because we're in the midst of a revival service. And I want to tell you something on this part. I heard a pastor share this many, many years ago, and I continue to remember his words ringing out. It's hard to have a burden for lost souls when you don't even have a burden to come to worship. Stung a little, didn't it? When we don't even have a burden to come and worship the Lord, how can we have a burden to tell them about Christ? Paul had a burdened heart to see as many people as he could come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. But he didn't stop there. Skip to chapter 10 and verse 1. Because when we skip down to chapter 10 and verse 1, we see that Paul says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. He had a burdened heart that they would turn from the law, turn from their merit, turn from their thinking of their natural descent, that they would be saved, and he prayed for them. He had a desire for them. He wanted them to turn. You see, Israel did not feel that they needed salvation. And there was a time Paul would have agreed with him. He himself opposed the gospel. He considered Jesus Christ an impostor. And Israel considered the Gentiles in need of salvation, but the Jews were not. I want you to understand tonight that Paul is telling them it doesn't matter what tribe you come from, you still need Jesus. I want to tell you tonight, it doesn't matter how long you've sat on that pew, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you need to be saved. There's a lot of people who go to church every single Sunday and sit in every single service, but they never confess their sin, and they never ask Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of their life. And in the end, as Jesus himself said, there will be men who say, Lord, Lord, look at all these things that I've done. And he says, depart from me, for I never knew you. See, Israel had a zeal for God. But it wasn't according to knowledge. Paul himself had zeal,
He had a zeal for the law. He had a zeal for Moses. He had a zeal for the Old Testament. He had a zeal for Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He didn't have anything for Jesus Christ. And it wasn't until Paul walked down the Damascus Road and he was struck by a light, and that light spoke to him, and he accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. He went on down the road. And there's a passage of scripture that a lot of people don't pay attention to. Because it says, over in the book of Acts, when Paul was blinded by the light, it says his eyes were covered in scales. And what happened when he got baptized? They fell off. And when they fell off, Jesus took him out into the desert, according to the book of Galatians, and taught him. And taught him. Guys, you want to know what's wrong with many people today? They hadn't been listening when Jesus has been speaking. We need a prayerful heart. We need a burdened heart, but we need a prayerful heart. We need a prayerful heart to teach people that there is an ignorance that comes from a lack of opportunity. But Israel had so many opportunities, and so do we. I hear people tell me all the time, well, what about people who live in the jungle? What about people who live here? What about people who live there? I want you to understand that Jesus Christ himself said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall stand forever. And he also said that nothing would happen until his word was published into the entire world. Everyone, man, woman, and child, will have the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We cannot claim ignorance. You say, well, how do I know that? Go to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1 and verse 20. It tells us that the Godhead, and I want you to think about this for just a second, that everyone who has experienced things of this earth are without excuse. Even the Gentiles knew there was a God. Even the Jews knew there was a God. And even the Jews knew that the law was pointing to something bigger. And they still claimed ignorance. As I want you to understand today, when you stand before God, you can't say, I didn't know. You can't say, I didn't know, because somebody out there had told you about the gospel. Somebody out there has shared the gospel. Somebody out there has prayed for you. Somebody out there has had a burden for you. Somebody out there has told you that Jesus Christ loves you and died on a cross and rose again so that you can live an eternal life with him forevermore. See, Paul is showing us here in this passage of Scripture that their confidence was in their lineage, not their salvation. And Paul also showed us that there's many a people today that are just like these people. They make the same mistakes. They think that their good works and their religious deeds will save them, when actually these practices are keeping them from ever being saved. Yeah. Because they're putting their faith and trust in their works and their deeds instead of the works and deeds of Jesus Christ. And I want to tell you tonight, some of those people are sincere. Some of those people are devout. But sincerity and devotion is never able to save the soul. Only one thing that can save the soul, and that's the blood of Jesus Christ. That's it. Romans chapter 10 is a great chapter. We get some great verses out of this, right? Romans 10 and 9, that thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. He didn't say maybe. He didn't say might be. He said, if you confess the Lord Jesus and believe it in your heart, you would be saved. There are no maybes when it comes to this. You either are or you're not. I like verse 13 myself.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Well, that's good, right? But there's a verse in here that a lot of people don't pay attention to. And that's verse 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing cometh by the word of God. What was wrong with the Jews? They didn't listen. And Paul's prayer was that they would have their eyes opened and their ears opened. That they would hear the truth. They would hear that the law only pointed, it was only a shadow, it was only a schoolmaster to teach them of Jesus Christ. You see, the law, according to the scriptures, faded away when something better came along. Hebrews teaches us that, right? Our rest is not found in what we do. Our rest is found in what He did.
Amen.
And we should be praying that people have their ears open to the Word of God, that they would be saved according to the truth. So we can see a Paul heart has a burden for all souls. A prayer that their ears would be opened. But now I want you to skip down to Romans chapter 11 and verse 33. Verse 33 of Romans chapter 11. He says, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments, and His ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Or who hath been His counselor? Or who hath first given to Him, and it shall be recompensed unto Him again? For of Him, and through Him, and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever. Amen." He had a burden for lost souls. He had a prayer that their ears would be opened, but he had a heart that was amazed in the God that he served. You see, as Paul considers God's great plan, he breaks into this spontaneous praise, and he realizes that God's ways are past us knowing. We don't understand the ways of God. We don't understand the thoughts of God. His wisdom and His knowledge are beyond our understanding. Guys, there is no amount of knowledge that we could ever come to that would even touch the lower part of what God knows.
Right.
By the way, these quotations are from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 13, and Job chapter 41 and verse 11. They emphasize both God's wisdom and sovereign conduct, I should say. But I was intrigued at verse 35. Who hath first given to Him, and it shall be recompensed unto Him again? Can anyone outgive God? Can anyone outgive God? God has given us the greatest thing that we could ever have. He gave us His Son. No one can give anything greater. And Jesus Christ gave us the greatest thing that He had, which was His life. No greater love hath any man than to lay down His life for his friend. You see, God gave us the greatest thing He could give. Jesus gave us the greatest thing He could give us. And we don't have anything to give Him greater than that. Well, you can't outgive God. And I love that last part of that verse. because he will never need anyone to repay a debt to him. He don't have to pay anyone back. He don't owe anyone anything. And let's be honest for just a second. We live in a world today where people think somebody owes them something all the time. You owe me. You know, I came from such and such a place. You owe me something. You owe me this or you owe me that. The problem is, guys, God didn't owe us anything. He gave us what we needed. He gave us a Savior. He doesn't owe us any more than that. But we owe him everything. We owe him everything. He was amazed. And I don't know about you today, but I am amazed every single day. I open the Word of God and begin to study it. I'm amazed that a God so righteous and so just and so wonderful even thought about loving someone. I'm amazed every single day that he allows me to get up out of bed. I'm amazed every single day that he loves me even when I reject him. And by the way, I don't want anyone in this room tonight to say, well, I've never rejected God because you're lying. Most of the time you reject him before you ever get out of bed. Most of the time we reject him in the things that we even think, much less the things we say. And think he still loves us anyway. And think, as I mentioned last night, he's just like that father to that lost son. Many times he comes running to us when we don't even think about going to him. Most of the time, we're like that lost son, right? We're like that prodigal son. We're thinking of all the excuses that we can make so the Father would take us back. We're trying to think, you know, just let me be a servant. I wonder if he'll even let me live here, or I wonder if he'll let me do this, or I wonder if he'll let me do that, and we don't even realize that the Father is in the process of running to us before we ever make it there. It should amaze us. And tonight, guys, I want you to understand, if we really and truly want revival, we need to stand in front of amazing God. He is truly amazing. He is truly wonderful. And every single day, we should worship him for the amazing things that he has done. The Israelites, more than anybody, should have realized how amazing and wonderful he was. When he brought them out of Egypt, he gave them a cloud by day, he gave them fire by night, he gave them water out of a rock, he gave them quail to eat, he gave them manna on the ground. Their shoes never wore out, their clothes never faded, and yet they rejected him. Don't say you wouldn't do it, because we're not near as close to him as they are, and we complain about everything. Sure is hot in here, right? It's cold. I shared with you the other night, I think back. Man, it's been a long, long time, but I do think back. We didn't have central heat there. I think back. Date myself here for a little bit. I think back and I remember sitting on the pews that were pinchy if you just sat just right. But yet the church house would be full. We have more modern amenities and less people. Because people aren't amazed with the fact that God loves them and God gives them air to breathe. God gives them another day on this earth when they don't even deserve it. Well, what would we do if we truly worship God for the amazing God he is? Tonight, tonight in closing. I really want you to focus on verse 36. Because Paul sums up his heart in this one verse. He says, for of him. I want you to think about that for just a second. For of him. He is talking about the plan of salvation. The plan came from God. It was not man's idea. It wasn't my idea. And it wasn't your idea. We didn't come together and say, you know what, I've offended God and I got to find some way back to him. We didn't do that. God knew before he ever created Adam, he was going to have this plan. By the way, we can go get all the self-help we want. I want to be honest with you tonight. There's not a section in Barnes & Noble big enough to handle all our failures. You see, in our spiritual indifference, we didn't care about a plan. To be honest, we're probably not even smart enough or wise enough to make one. It's all him. He made the plan. We should have a burden to tell lost souls that salvation is his plan, not mine. Notice what else he says. And through him. Even if we had the plan, we couldn't make it happen. We couldn't free ourselves from the prison of sin. We can't even free ourselves from the prison of ourselves. It can only happen through him. It can only happen through Jesus Christ. What Jesus experienced in a small amount of time would take you and I an eternity to pay for. What he went through in 3 days, in 3 nights, it would take us forever to deal with. Salvation was of him and through him. We didn't have anything to do with it. Because here's the deal. If I had something to do with it, I'd brag about it. Many years ago, I heard the story of a preacher and a cab driver. It was quite funny. The preacher was in a cab. They had an accident. They both died. They stand before the Lord. The preacher looks at the Lord. He said, I'll let the cab driver go first. The Lord begins to judge the cab driver, and he looks up on top of the hill. Up on top of the hill was a mansion. And the cab driver got him a big mansion, and it was beautiful. On top of the hill, overlooking everything. The Lord looked down at the preacher and he had a little shack down in the valley. And the preacher thought to himself, wait a minute. I preached every single Sunday. I did everything that you told me to do. How did he get a shack, a mansion, and I get a shack? And the Lord said, well, when he drove, people prayed, and when you preached, people slept. You see, the preacher went into it looking at it from his merit. What he done instead of what God done. We have to have a burden to tell people that the plan is of God. We have to have a prayerful heart to teach them that it's through Christ. That God would speak through us, that they would hear the words of Christ and be saved. But notice what he says at the end. And to it's of him, through him, and to him. It's not for me. It's not for you. It's all to him. According to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 6, it's to the praise of the glory of his grace. It's for his pleasure that we are created and we find our fulfillment in bringing him glory and him honor.
Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 21 says, unto him be glory. Where? In the church. When we are saved, we should be amazed and bring him glory in the amazement that we have of him. So tonight, where's your heart? We should have a Paul heart that's burdened to tell lost souls, that's prayerful that he speaks through us, and that's amazed that he ever loved us anyway. Tonight, pay attention to those three things in verse 36. Salvation is not for me, it's not for you, it's of him, through him, and to him. He did it for his glory. He did it for his honor. He did it for his purpose. You and I are only the recipients of salvation. We don't have anything to do with its purpose. We don't have anything to do with who gives it. We don't even get to choose who gets it. The only thing we can do is accept it. Tonight, if you're saved, I implore you to have a Paul heart. Be burdened for those lost souls. Be prayerful for those lost souls, and be in amazement that God loves those lost souls. But if you're not saved, I want you to understand tonight that Jesus Christ loved you and he gave his life for you, that if you would believe on him, you would have everlasting life. Come to Jesus today. Let him have his way in your life. Accept him as Lord and Savior. Believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's where salvation's at. You'll never make it. The only way that you and I can experience eternal life is through Jesus Christ. Would you stand tonight as Brother Ben comes, Brother Dan brings our invitation? It's my prayer tonight that our hearts would be like Paul. It's also my prayer tonight that if you have a heart tonight that doesn't have Jesus Christ, that you would accept it today. Let Jesus Christ create a clean heart, a new heart inside of you. Let him be the Lord and Savior. Brother Daniel.
Look before your own eyes.
Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is the Savior's love for me. You know, when it was in the garden, he prayed, and he shed no tears for his own griefs, but sweat and drops of blood for mine. That love of God that drives a sinner to his knees in repentance and crying out to God for mercy and salvation is that same grace that ought to drive a child of God up off his knees and out there to tell the rest of the world what God's done for. You know, God gives us a saving grace, and God gives us grace to serve by. You know, and if you don't know Christ today, salvation is in no other person than the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved of a necessity, because there is no other option. You don't have multiple choices. You only have one choice. It's either Christ or it's eternity in hell. And as a child of God, we ought to be broadcasting and proclaiming that message adamantly, fervently, passionately, every chance that we get. God loves us, and that love should amaze us and drive us to want to praise Him, to worship Him, and tell others about Him. I'll stop that sermon right there so we get to go home tonight with you. Thank you for another challenging message from God's Word, and I hope everybody truly has listened to the message tonight. They've been listening all week to the messages that we have heard. Revival comes by not just hearing, but understanding and doing God's Word as well. Do you remember services tomorrow night? Same time. Any other announcements before we dismiss?
Brother Ben, new sub at Casco will be in revival starting the 29th, 30th, and 31st with Brother Tony Croft. Casco at 7 p.m.
Okay. Remember this. Any others? It is always good to have Brother Booth with us. Will you dismiss us in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, we're thankful to be able